In my last video, I quickly summarized how I went about replicating one of Ask's pieces. I wasn't really expecting the video to blow up like it did, so a huge thank you to everyone who has watched, commented, and gave the seals of approval. It was a joy and very humbling to read through hundreds of comments on my first video. I tried my best to reply to everyone and also made a list of feedback to hopefully improve my videos going forwards. This video is sort of the logical progression of the previous, where I attempt to apply what I had learned. Also, I had planned. With this picture as the reference, I did my best to create something similar but different. But what I realized is that I severely underestimated how tricky it is to draw hair in an ass style. In the end, this is what I managed. While the illustration on screen here is not terrible, I think we can all agree that the rendering on the hair is far from how ass draws the character's hair from 7 years ago. Hello everyone, it's me again. After clearly learning less than I had hoped, I spent the week compiling some recent illustrations and decided to make this video which summarizes what I think are the factors that make Ask's style theirs. A quick disclaimer as usual, what will be presented in this video might not be relevant to all of Ask's illustrations, and your mileage will likely vary with your own level of experience. That being said, I do believe that this video will help many either start rendering hair like Ask or do their own study of Ask's illustrations. For my analysis, I look at the following factors: line art, color choices, and rendering on some of the more recent illustrations that I enjoy. Beginning with the line art, like most artists, Ask mainly uses the line art for defining the main shapes of the hair rather than all the details. While we do see a lot of lines present within the main bulk of the hair itself, I would rather group them into the rendering instead. The main reason is that personally, it is a lot easier to add and adjust these finer lines during the rendering phase when we can actually see the forms better. Having them on the same layer also makes it difficult to change the color later, and the same problem arises when we try to erase if we didn't like how we placed them in the first place. As such, I would keep the line art layer mainly as a way to define the outer boundaries of the forms and only use it for details sparingly. The second thing about Ask's line art is that there is some variety in the line weight. Thicker lines appears to be used for the ends of the bundle of a hair, as well as some curved and straight sections. It seems to be used to separate certain parts more clearly, but the exact thickness is likely a matter of preference. The third point for line art is that it tends to be nice and smooth, which suggests that a G-pen should suffice. The thicker lines are probably drawn in using a wider brush, or doubling up on the lines. There are some cases where the line art seems to have a rough texture, but I wouldn't worry about it for now, as the effects on the final illustration are minimal. Finally, don't forget to color your line art. In some cases, Ask seems to have included a little glow along the outer edges of the line art as well. Moving on to the colors, it is important to note that the color choices for the hair is very much tied into the rest of the illustration. Contrast is a concept of how different two elements are, and artists very much use this concept to draw attention to areas they want the viewers to focus on. The same applies to Ask's illustration. Some examples include this piece on Surtur that uses color contrast. Ask chose to tint Surtur's usually red hair more orange, which is the complement of blue. This other one uses value contrast, where Surtur's hair is made darker to stand out from the lighter backdrop. In essence, it is important to take into account the overall composition when choosing colors. While I'm simply not experienced enough with colors to tell you exactly what Ask is doing with the colors, as a rule of thumb, I see values as a way of determining the harshness of the light and therefore the overall mood of the illustration. And since hues are often fixed by the character's design, saturation then becomes like an adjustment knob that I can turn to change what the viewer is looking at. On top of that, Ask also adds in some extra colors beyond that of the character's design, such as the usually warmer color along the border of the light area and the colorful highlights. If you would like to learn more about color theory, there are far more qualified individuals on YouTube such as Mark Brunette. If you're like me and are just drawing for fun, it is usually sufficient to just find references with colors you like to use and make minor adjustments by eye. Finally, we've arrived at the rendering. To help give an idea of where each step fits in the bigger picture, I will have this graphic on the side to show how each part relates to the layering structure. However, there might be some differences, so I will go through two examples after this section, so stay tuned. In general, Ask's hair rendering always have a bright light cast on the character's head. In this series, this tends to just be a fraction of the entire head since it is more dynamic and gives the viewer something to look at. However, if you look at some of the illustrations they have done for games like Girls Frontline, it can be entirely lit. In terms of the shape of the light, use a sphere for reference. A gentle gradient is also applied on the light areas in certain cases. You can add in the secondary color, or even fade it out as you go further away from the light source. As mentioned previously in the color section, there is also a warmer color around the borders of the light area. On top of these light areas, we have finer details drawn in using some of the darker or secondary colors. Since these define the form of the hair, be sure to follow the form of the head slash bundle of hair that you are drawing. Blocks of color might be added to define the transition along the light area. Once again, the exact amount is up to you, but Ask tends to only put in just enough to break up the shapes and leave the majority of the area clear for the clean, minimalistic look. The shadows are similar, with some really dark shadows blocked in, while the rest of it being added as a gradient on the main midtone. Just like the light areas, details in various colors are drawn in after to help define the forms better. Colorful highlights are then added on top. Sometimes there is a border effect on it, sometimes it is blurred out slightly, but in general it tends to be bigger in the middle and fades out as it goes to either side. Be sure to draw the highlights in a direction that is perpendicular to the strands of the hair. This is why for this illustration, the highlights here are curved up. Finally, some more strands of hair are added above the line art to give it the extra oomph. In general, this is how Ask seems to render their hair. However, art isn't an exact science, so there are cases where Ask makes use of their skill to create something that is more unique. Layer structuring-wise, I start off with the base layer. On top of that, I have a folder for the bigger blocks of color. In here, there's a gradient adjustment for the base, and layers for the light and shadows. This same light layer also contains the secondary color. Multiple layers are used for shadows here, because I'm breaking down the illustration. You can definitely use the same layer if it's more convenient. Moving on to the details folder, I have one detail layer for every type of color. Light, shadow, base, as well as the secondary color. Then one more layer for the highlights with a border effect. On top of this folder, the line art and extras layer. For this illustration of Asuka, things are similar, except I made use of a clipping mask for the details instead. This benefit of using a clipping mask is that it allows the underlying base layers to show through, and the different colors are airbrushed onto the same gradient layer I used to adjust the base layer overall. I will make the Clip Studio paint files of the breakdown available so you can check out the layers for yourselves. The link will be in the video description. For the last section of the video, I'll try to apply what I have learned in the drawing of my own character. For the colors, I'll be picking colors off of this illustration of Angelina from Arknights and tuning them a little redder by eye, as I don't want to keep the greenish composition in the original. I started off by drawing the line art. Here are the settings of the pen brush I'm using. I try to keep the line weights in mind as I'm drawing, so for the borders, I used a slightly thicker G pen than the others. After the initial lines are in, I also added another layer on top to put in some more thicker lines. For those who are curious, I switched to a normal layer because my tablet pen was acting up, and not because there was necessarily anything wrong with a vector layer. Now since this is a video on rendering hair, I'll just let the time-lapse play out as I render in the clothing and skin. Finishing the other parts first serves as a nice warm-up into rendering, and having the completed parts in front of me remind myself that I can do it and to push through as I trial and error my way through the parts that I'm unsure about. I find that staying motivated is very important in activities such as art that take a while to improve, so I suggest making it as comfortable as possible for yourself. This is also why I made the composition a little warmer and gave my character a gentle expression. Coming to the rendering of the hair, I started with filling the light areas using the lasso fill and paint bucket tools, as well as the G-pen for smaller areas. As usual, the tools are shown on screen. Once the majority is done, I used a smooth watercolor brush and blurred out the transition before adding in a warmer color along it on a separate layer. Here are the settings for the watercolor brush. Next, I added in some details on the new layer on top, drawing in some lines in the base color with the G-pen. I then airbrushed in some brighter colors and refined the details by erasing. Note that this is a good place to use a clipping mask if you're unsure, as it does not actually erase your airbrushed colors, leaving them available anytime, even if you cannot undo. Moving on, I also used the airbrush to add a gradient for the main midtone. Then some details in the secondary color. Similar to the transition on the head, these details are added to the transition of light and dark. Next, some shadows are added as well. Somewhere around here, the mental struggle began as I started to feel a little lost about what I'm doing. So I decided to color the line art to change it up a little. This really brought out the vibe that I thought was missing and convinced me that I'm on the right path. Following this, I then spent some time adding details to the shadow areas. At this point, most of the work is done and it's all about refining things here and there. Here I merged the secondary color and light layers because the light layer was showing slightly underneath, and working on two separate layers was becoming more trouble than it's worth. For the transition, I refined the edges using a clipping mask as mentioned before, however, I have applied it on the folder instead since there was another layer being used to adjust the light layer. You will see the highlights being put in here, but since I redrew them later, I'll just skip them for now. As I make more adjustments to the darker areas, because of the way I overlapped the hair, I had to use a select tool to select an area before airbrushing the colors. The polyline tool is very useful for this purpose. Note that you can shift click or alt click to either select or unselect more areas if necessary. Now that most of the rendering is done, I created the extras layer and added some more strands of hair. I added a bunch because my character has messy hair as part of the design. Finally, to wrap up, I added a glow to the line as we have seen in the references before. To do so, I control-click on the layer, which creates a selection based on the contents of that layer. Then I go to the Select menu, expand selection, and just increase it by a few pixels. I then make a layer underneath the line art and fill it with color I want. Then I go to Filter, Blur, Gaussian Blur, and add some in. Because I only want the glow to show on the outer edges, I move it all the way below the color layers. I also readjusted the highlights here because the previously drawn ones didn't look right. I also added the border effect manually because I wanted to add a gradient to the colors. And that's the end of my attempt. After putting the illustrations side by side, overall, I can see some resemblance of the style, but I definitely lack something in comparison to Ask's illustrations. Personally, I also feel that my line art lacks the same presence, but I'm not sure if it is the thickness or perhaps the colors that cause it to feel less impactful. In terms of the colors, since I'm the one who picked it, I'll let you decide if it looked like Ask. I didn't necessarily think about Ask when I was picking them though, just what looked alright to me while I was rendering. Rendering-wise, I followed my points from before, and unlike the illustration in the opening of the video, I had something to guide myself along when I felt lost this time, which is a huge plus. The overall outcome is rather decent, but after my attempt, I realized that I lacked an understanding of the forms of the hair. While I may have the coloring portion down to a certain extent, Ask always managed to create visually interesting hair, whereas in my attempt, there are these rather boring looking areas. I tried to make it more interesting by inserting some details here and there, but it seems rather un-Ask-like. Going any further than this would probably be too messy, which is why I stopped. Ask manages to strike a balance between keeping things simple and detailed enough to be interesting. This balance seems to be the key to success, which unfortunately seems to be beyond my understanding at the moment. Here's one last look at the different stages of completion. Again for reference, the line art and rendering process took around 5.5 hours, but another one or two more was probably spent in the sketching phase beforehand. I hope you have enjoyed and found this video useful in your journey. It was definitely more challenging to make this time, as I was constantly learning new things along the way and had to double back, rewrite my script, and rethink the best way to present my ideas. I hope that the video has been clear enough throughout, so let me know in the comments below if it is not. Apologies to those who might have been hoping for a different artist, but I'll definitely be looking at someone else for my next video. Thank you again for the warm reception of my first video. To my new viewers, if you enjoy the content that I'm making, consider giving the channel a subscribe, and I'll see you in the next one.